Hello and welcome. As Peter said, I'm going to be chairing the discussion. I'm Kirsty Lang. I present front row on Radio 4. A couple of housekeeping things. First of all, if a fire alarm does go off, it's not a test, so get out. Two exits there, and there will be staff directing you to the meeting point, which is the brasserie. So, what we're going to try and do in this debate is not argue the case for why we need diversity, because I think Peter set that out very well. This is going to be more of a question of how you do it. I'm going to be debating that with five distinguished panellists who are going to share their own experiences in this area, and what I hope will be a focused and quite practical discussion on choices and programming decisions. Each of the panellists is going to talk about a project or projects that they've been involved in and some of the problems that they have faced along the way. But I hope we're going to, as I say, focus rather on the creative challenges more than management ones. And I think this brings me to what I hope will be the key focus of this debate. Diversity should not be seen as some politically correct box-ticking exercise, but as an exciting opportunity to get new audiences, more bums on seats, and tap into a wider pool of talent, which, as Baz said, will provide new ideas and fresh narratives. There will be an opportunity for all of you to join in. Each of the panelists is going to speak for about 3 to 5 minutes. I'll ask each of them a couple of questions, and then at about 11:15, we will open it out to you. Well, let me now welcome my panel onto the stage. I'm going to sit down first, Bags, the middle seat. I'd like to invite Dawn Walton, who is the artistic director of the Eclipse Theatre Company. Dawn began her directing career at the Royal Court Theatre, going on to be awarded the first Jerwood Young Directors Award at the Young Vic. She formed Eclipse in 2010. It is the only black-led national touring company delivering an annual middle-scale tour to regional theatres. And Dawn recently delivered a digital commission for The Space. It was 10 short films written by 10 black writers from across the UK. Tamara Rocco, who is the lead principal and artistic director of the English National Ballet since 2012. Tamara's danced the Scottish Ballet and then the Royal Ballet as principal. She's also on the board of Arts Council East, Dance UK, and is a patron of the Ipswich-based Dance East Academy. Skinder Hundal, who is chief executive of the New Art Exchange in Nottingham, a contemporary visual arts space that celebrates the region's cultural richness and diversity. It's the largest gallery in the UK dedicated to a culturally diverse contemporary visual arts scene. There are exhibitions, creative activities for families, young people, film screenings, symposiums, lectures, festivals, live performance, music, dance, theatre. And Skinder's also chair of DARBA, the UK premier festival for Indian classical music in Leicester. Maria Oshodi is the artistic director of Extant, which she founded in 1997. It is Britain's only professional performing arts company of visually impaired people. It's based in London, but they tour in England and sometimes internationally. And last but not least, Rufus Norris, who will this April succeed Nicholas Heitner as director of the National Theatre. He's been an associate director at the National since 2011. He currently has on stage Behind the Beautiful Forevers by David Hare, based on the book by Catherine Boo about the Bombay slums, which opened earlier last month. Rufus was an associate director at the Young Vic as well, and his other work has included Cabaret and Country Girl in the West End. But let me start in the order in which I introduce them with Dawn Walton. Dawn.
Hello, good morning. I'm going to talk a little bit about what Eclipse has been doing over the last few years. We're a company, we're based in Sheffield. We are fortunate to live in the beautiful Crucible. We're a resident company in the Crucible Theatre, which is quite a lot of fun, particularly when it turns into a sports arena once a year. It's cool. The company has a history that started as an initiative out in the regions that came out of the Eclipse conference back in 2000. My engagement with it was much later on, as I became its first artistic director, and my first action was to form a company because I was concerned about the legacy and the future of the organisation. So that was my first move. Our mission is to influence and instigate change that leads to a more diverse and equitable theatrical landscape. The simpler way of saying that is the company's all about diversity and the company's all about equality. Although we've become increasingly multi-platform, our primary landscape is and remains theatre. We've been doing this in a number of ways. The first thing is we've been pushing the programming of mainstream theatres across the regions by delivering high quality, middle scale touring productions each year. We've literally been putting diversity on stage in regional theatres. The second way we've been doing this is alongside that, we've developed our own unique audience development programme. That now delivers on average up to 32% new bookers for the venues across our tours. We're managing to entertain and engage regular theatre-going audiences. At the same time, we're bringing new audiences to the theatre, increasing engagement within the arts. The third thing we've been doing is raising the profile of black artists. Oh, this is easier to read outside of the thing. Great. Much better. Raising the profile of black artists, especially the more isolated black artists outside of London. The best example was the project that Kirsty referred to, which was 10 by 10, which was a project that we did having won one of the commissions for the space pilot. We worked with 10 black writers from across the UK, brought them to Sheffield, did a workshop, and sent them off to write short films. And we commissioned them all, developed them all, I directed them all, and we produced that work. And it works as a kind of wonderful showcase, really, of black talent across England. Which leads me on to where they now reside. They live on our digital platform, which is Eclipse TV, which we use as a way, we only get to tour once a year in terms of funding. And we're aware that building audiences, we want to continue to have a dialogue with those audiences. So we've created a sort of online platform, as it were. So we have a virtual presence, if you like, when we're not touring. So to the future, we've been looking at, so we've made quite a number of inroads. I think we've toured to over 40 venues across the UK. Our work's been seen by about 130, up to 130 audiences across the UK. But there's still more work to be done. And that work is the what work we show and the frequency with which we deliver it. There's also a missing story that we're not telling on our British stages, and that's the missing black story. So we're going to take that on. And we take that on with our project called Revolution Mix, which is an ambitious 3-year project that will act as a catalyst for permanent change in British theatre through the largest ever delivery of black British stories in regional theatres on the middle scale. It's a 3-year project. The body of work we're looking to produce at least will be 6 middle scale pieces, 1 small scale piece. Really, we're going to commission that so that we can go out and do our audience development work alongside that, and I'll explain that a bit more in a second. 2 films, we have a digital platform, and we're aware that a lot of our audiences will engage on that with that platform before they come to the live events, as it were. And a radio play. I'm very conscious of the fact that there is virtually no work for the growing population of visually impaired black men, black and Asian men in particular, my father being one of them, so that's my major inspiration in that. And I will add that one of the pieces must be for an all-female cast. The first year of our project will be development. We'll be identifying the writers that we want to work with from across the UK. My inbox is currently filling rapidly as I speak. Every day, more and more people are making themselves known to us. This is a good thing. There's more people out there than we realise. The second year, and we'll work in conjunction with regional theatres and our partners to spend a year developing the pieces after having a starting workshop with us in Sheffield. The second year was about audiences. We'll be doing our small-scale tour, taking that to all the participating theatres and to some hard-to-reach areas. And that will allow us to deliver probably the biggest audience development programme that we've ever done across the UK. And then year three, and I can't find a better word of it, so I'm going to say festival. It's not my favourite word, but it feels that that's the best word I can find, which is about all the rest of the work being produced across the UK. So there's more than one event, there's more than one piece of work at a time, which is a problem, I think, for Black theatre. What's significant, I think, is that... Oh, yeah, sorry. There's one more thing. If we're going to work that hard and produce that much work, I think under the umbrella of a project as ambitious as Revolution Mix, we're going to sort of take on workforce. It's frustrating and brilliant. It's frustrating to you can work with a number of theatres, but actually once you go upstairs, I become a singular person. I personally become a singular person in that, in terms of diversity, who delivers that work. We believe that most people that work, certainly in theatres, start their relationship as audience members. Start their relationship with the theatre as audience members. So we believe if we diversify the work and we diversify the audiences, then we can diversify the workforce. So that's what we're going to try and take on. So I have an ambition to deliver a production assistant, to make a new production assistant, a marketing assistant, and a producer over the course of Revolution Mix. We'll do that through internships, etc., but I won't get into too many details about that. So it's a legacy project, really. We're looking to the future and we're looking to kind of avoid the Groundhog Day that Mia Sahal talked about, that in 10 years' time we'll be having the same conversation. The way that we're working is the legacy, we hope, is creating relationships between regional theatres and local Black artists, creating lasting relationships between regional theatres and their new audiences, bringing more people into the buildings. When they come into the buildings, they'll see a diverse atmosphere and consider it as somewhere that they might be welcome to work to. That's it.
Thank you very much. So Dawn, you've obviously got a lot of exciting stuff coming up, but I'd like to focus a little bit on your experience up till now. Mm-hmm. As you say, you're pretty much one of the only companies of this kind that does mid-scale touring. Mm-hmm. What sort of problems have you had doing that? I'd like to hear a little bit more about your experience of reaching new audiences and how you've gone about it.
Okay, well, the two things are very much tied together, because I developed an audience development program because of some of the obstacles I was experiencing when trying to sell our shows on the middle scale to regional theatres. This feeling of risk that they might not have an audience for it. And every Black company that's ever done touring, anybody Black age company, you would have heard this. So my attitude was, well, then I'll bring an audience, is really what it is. And so our audience development is quite straightforward, actually. If you want someone to come to your party, it's probably a good idea to go and meet them. That's really what our audience development is. It's really, the postcode marketing thing just does my head in. It makes no sense to me. I don't read junk mail. So if I don't know you, I ain't gonna read your mail. It's really simple. So we go out and meet people early. And I don't think I'm doing anything new. I do think that a lot of the practice that we do were practiced in the 80s by black touring companies way back when. They were doing this practice a long time ago.
How do you do it? How do you go out and meet people?
Well, you kind of do some research. You go and find the council offices, youth groups, etc., etc. So you do that research and then you go to the city. What's really significant is that you have to go to the city early. You can't do it the week before or quite often in the week that the tour's going on because it's too late. So we do it, usually we find the optimum time is at least 2 months beforehand. So we go out and we go up there and we meet people. Now, the thing that's really interesting, certainly when you step outside of London, is that quite a lot of the cities, it's not that hard to identify groups that are hard to reach because people kind of live that geographically that way. In a lot of cities, not all, but in many. So you can kind of identify groups. Now, there's a really simple thing that actually when you hit the street, you can ask people and they'll tell you, oh, so-and-so in whatever shop, he's the guy or she's the woman that organises the trips to the theatre, organises the minibus, etc. I mean, it's that underground. And I always say what we do with audience development is we join the underground with the overground. So when we're out doing the audience development, quite often they'll tell you, if you really want to reach these people, you need to talk to this radio station. My marketing department, my marketing company, Mobius, who are brilliant, will respond to that and engage with those people immediately. So the intelligence from the ground, if you like, goes directly back to our marketing. It's all one thing. All our audience development is part of our marketing. The two things are joined up. Once we've identified a number of community leaders, then I'll go up and meet those people. We'll set up a meeting in the theatre. 9 times out of 10, those people have never been in that building before. We'll introduce them and we'll tell them stuff. I try not to do too much. I show off a bit. Tell them a bit about the show, is the truth. Tell them a bit about the show. But mostly, my time is spent asking them about themselves, what they do, what are the challenges, what are their relationship with the arts, and try and understand that. And those people then go out and advocate
for
the show.
And what's your pitch to those people about why they should be bringing, you know, apart from the fact that you've got a great entertaining show, but...
I go and tell them about the show.
Yeah.
That's it.
That's it.
I mean, most of the time, most of the people don't know about the shows that are going on.
So it's like,
I've
got this great entertaining show.
This is it. This is what we're doing. Here's some pictures. These are the actors. This is what the story was. Invariably, they're very excited about seeing the show. They don't think that work goes on in those buildings necessarily, or they don't necessarily feel welcome, whatever the history is. So it's as common sense as that, really. There is another factor as well. It depends who goes and has... It is important who goes and has those conversations. Invariably, buildings historically have sent people out who just kind of annoy people when they go out and meet them, is the truth. The wrong people are going and talking to the potential audiences, or they turn up in October and start twittering on about Black History Month when they've not had any conversation with any of those people ever before. People aren't stupid, they just kind of find it a bit patronising, really. So when we turn up, we're interested in who they are. We talk to those people continually through the year, so when we come back, they know us and they say, when are you coming back? Actually, I get a lot of calls from in the lead up to Black History Month with people asking me, do you know what's on? And I'll say, yes, go and see that show in Manchester. We haven't got anything in Sheffield, but there's something over there in Leeds. I know there's that show there. People literally use us that way now. That's the stage that we've got to, which is a powerful, it's a conversation. And that's how we do it.
Dawn, thank you very much, and I'm sure we'll be coming back to you in a moment, but I'm now going to pass the baton on to Tamara Rocco. Hello.
For us, for English National Ballet, I think the diversity challenge is something we approach in two ways. One way is specific projects and collaborations, but another way that, for me, has a more lasting effect is everyday decisions. And so I'll go into the collaborations first. And when I arrived to English National Ballet 2 years ago, the repertoire was a very traditional repertoire. I would say 99% of the choreography was by white men. And it had been that case, I think, almost for the whole of our history of 65 years. every production, almost every production, had been created by a white middle-aged man. So one of the first things that I realized I had to do was to change our repertoire and to find collaborators that had a different cultural perspective to that traditional historic one. And one of the first collaborations or collaborators I seeked was Akram Khan. He came and created Dust for us as part of the anniversary program of the First World War. And again, he will be creating Giselle for us. And the idea behind specifically Giselle was that this is a very traditional part of the classical repertoire. And I wanted a different cultural perspective, a different angle into something that is perceived as very traditional. And the idea behind that was both to include this cultural perspective, to allow our traditional audiences to feel confident enough with the work that they will be willing to come to a program by an Asian choreographer, even by mixing both cultures or both traditions, and at the same time to try and break those perceptions of our own company by hopefully attracting the audiences that follow Akram, both because of his kata background and because of his contemporary background, to come and see a ballet company, something that they might not always consider is for them. And I think so far with Dust, we've realized that it is working. It's been incredibly successful artistically, but also from all the other points of views. It's something as well that has opened many international doors for us. This spring, we're going to go on tour all over the world. And one of the things they really want is this piece of work. It opened as well Glastonbury for us. We perform in front of people that had never gone to the ballet and in a very different ambience outside a traditional theater. And it was quite overwhelming for both the audience and ourselves. Of course, another angle is we are a touring company. And so far, all of this work has been focused in London. We felt that challenging our audiences was easier in London. But it's something that now we're confident enough that because of its success, we're actually now bringing it to all our touring or to some of our touring locations. Because I do want to challenge the perception that you have to do a certain work in London and a different kind of work outside London. So that's one of the specific projects. Another part of our work is outreach. And we reach about 48,000 people a year, many of them with disabilities, about 4,500 children. We work with them in their schools or we bring them to our theaters. And one of the projects that I'm most passionate and proud is our Dance for Parkinson's project for elderly people that suffer from Parkinson's disease. It's something that we started again in London, but now we have extended to Liverpool, Oxford, Cardiff, Wales, and Ipswich. But even more impressive, because we've become leaders of this, we're now collaborating with Australia so that they can also absorb all our knowledge and our experience and they can expand it in Australia and around Europe. So I think that's, again, something I'm very proud. It is also, as I say, everyday decisions. Our ticket prices start at £12 because traditionally the perception is that we are an expensive art form for a very few. And we see that by making it accessible, hopefully our audiences will become more varied. Through our choreographic workshops, we try to encourage female choreographers. And that's something that has proven quite challenging. Women tend not to want to come forward. So again, it's something that as an artistic director, you have to make quite specific decisions about who you approach, even if they don't want to, and kind of force them into it for the first time. And hopefully,
we'll do choreography.
Yes, and you will apply to the Dance UK leadership programs, and you will apply to the all the different possibilities that are there that for some reason women tend not to apply. I feel that since I am in a position that I should encourage them.
So for mentoring and...
Yes, yeah. About mentoring and yeah, it's about their own perception of what they can achieve.
Tamara, I want to ask you,
yeah.
As you've said, I mean, ballet in particular has this this white male canon that many of your core audience, I imagine, are quite attached to and expect to see. Mm. So how do you overcome that problem?
By challenging that, by changing it, and by creating different role models as well. I mean, ourselves as an organization, we are, again, an all-female leading team. The executive director, the artistic director, the development director, the marketing director, the financial director, everyone is a woman. So that already is
positive. But I mean, are you conscious of alienating that core audience, I suppose?
No, I don't think they... I think they're a lot more open-minded than you think. I mean, we have 22 nationalities in our dances. We, for the first time, we had at the Albert Hall with 5,000 people, all three leading roles of Romeo and Juliet were by black men. The opening night at the Coliseum, the leading couple was a black and Asian couple. I have now black core de ballet girls, which is something that people never thought it was possible to have black girls in a white swan core de ballet or in a snowflakes core de ballet. So, as I said, it is about everyday decisions, not just about a specific project, to be able to change the audience's perception and even the practice's perception as well. Some of those choreographers were surprised the first time that said, this is your corps de ballet and this is who you have to work with. And they've never maybe considered that possibility of having black snowflakes. But there they are and they're wonderful. And now no one now questions it. So as soon as we normalize it, and we provide those role models for those children that we work with, and they realize that it is possible, that you can have a space in an art form that maybe you thought wasn't open to you, that I do hope that, as you say, they start in the audience, they become practitioners, and one day they will become leaders too.
Mm-hmm. Tamara, thank you very much. I'm conscious of time, so... Skinder Hundal on the case from Nottingham.
Thank you. Thank you, Kirsty, and thank you, Baz, for the invite. And thank you, audience. So New Art Exchange is based in an inner city area called Hyson Green in Nottingham. It was born from two roots-based organisations, which I was a volunteer of in the 90s. So that was my entry point into the arts. And I always say that New Art Exchange, based in a place like Hyson Green, is a space where the street never lies. And in its name itself, it talks about exchanging art in new ways. So we're about refreshing and rethinking how the arts ecology works and rethinking who curates, who makes, who consumes art, and always constantly rethinking this. And so for us, collaboration and reaching communities becomes a really important part of our work. Our mission is very much about stimulating new perspectives about the value of diversity. And we talk about the value of art and culture in a big way today. And we look at valuing what diversity means in both art and society and how society influences art and vice versa in terms of the narratives that come out of our space. We put on exhibitions, we commission, We take on touring work as well. We have our own theatre group called Yard, which is about the next generation of leaders. And the creative case for us is something that is like oxygen for us. So it's something that we breathe and do every day. And we have been doing this for 20-odd years. And as a new venue, over 6 years, as New Art Exchange, there's been much progress. And a lot of that progress is very much down to collaboration. And so the collaboration I'd like to talk about, one that we're doing at the moment, there's many to talk about, but there's one in particular at the moment, is where we're working with a museum called Galleries of Justice, which is based in the city centre of Nottingham. It's very much a space which looks at the English history around the justice system. And the opportunity they have is to engage a wider demographic, and they're not reaching black minority ethnic groups at the moment. So the New Art Exchange team has teamed up with them on a senior level with their sort of leadership management group, with the chief execs and the creative teams coming together to devise a program which works with a creative team from the community itself and engaging the community. So the project is very much about how do you transform a space like Galleries of Justice by exploring the histories of black minority ethnic groups in a space like Nottingham. So we're looking at the topic of civil rights, and we've got a catchy name called Get Up, Stand Up. So this is going to be looking at the sort of expression of communities. And if you think about the model that we're trying to instigate here, it's looking at the leadership within the museum and trying to transfer and learn what their context is and what our context is around thought leadership, around policy shift, about decisions and how they're made, and also about how a creative product can emerge from this project that's going to be of meaning and give significance to the communities so that they feel that they have an ownership of the space. So Get Up, Stand Up is something that's going to be launching in March. It'll be an installation piece. So it'll be looking at audiovisual technology, and it will aim to provide a space where people can share their histories and exchange and learn. I always think that the work we do is about reaching communities, and one of the thoughts that I was having before this session was, is it impossible or is it possible to reach every possible community out there? Well, I had a challenge when I first started. I came to the venue, and opposite the venue is a mosque, and every Friday there is a congregation that comes in particular. And I was with my academic, an artist in resident, Tasawwur Bashir, who's an artist who looks at the ontology of Sufi sound. And I said to him, I said, the congregation comes and it goes, it never crosses the road. Well, he said, well, it's quite clear. They see you as the tavern and them the temple. I said, that's interesting. Probably the case, because we have a bar. We have a lot of noise on Friday nights in particular, and a lot of different types of cultures coming together. And so I challenged him when he said this. I said, well, how do we crack the code? And he said, look, give me 4 weeks. And I'll have an answer for you. I said, fine. So he got to work, and he said he would call me from the reception phone, which he never calls from, and I have a basement office at the time. And lo and behold, 4 weeks later, I get this phone call from the receptionist, and she says, Tazawa would like to speak to you. And I thought, okay, he's cracked the code. Here we go. So I ran upstairs. I didn't even answer the phone. And lo and behold, the whole gallery was full of the congregation of Muslim men who'd just done their prayers. And I was wondering, so what's the story here? Well, the story was there were several elements to his success. The key thing was that he made the effort to cross the road and pray with the congregation. Now, being of Muslim origin himself, he was able to do this more easily than myself. So he entered the space on a very spiritual and personal level with the community, built the relationship with the community. But on top of that, he'd created a very interesting installation. And the installation was looking at the visualization of the Quran, which had never been done before. So this was the visualization of the Quran using data mapping software, data mapping techniques and artists to create this amazing swirling, whirling sort of a word map of the Quran and you can imagine that the word in the middle would be Allah, because it's the most repetitive word in the Quran in that sense. It was juxtaposed with a very interesting aesthetic around sort of Nusrat Fateh Ali Khan's voice, and it was a visualization of the Qawwali, where he'd worked with scientists from Jodrell Bank to create this visualization of a Qawwali Sufi singer and having a conversation and dialogue with the visualization of the Quran. Now, this was very literal for the community, and it engaged and connected. But creatively also, aesthetically, it was a very challenging piece. And of course, it could be contentious. So it was bringing the congregation in, easing the relationship first before they entered the space for them to then connect and have dialogue.
And then how do you keep them coming back? That's the other...
That's the challenge. That's because, yes, with audiences, for me, the recipe has to be offering the relevant product regularly and doing it with genuine intent. So the intent has to be very, very genuine. It can't be ticking boxes to hit the creative case target. It has to be something passionate, something inside you, and it has to be something that you want. And I think we're driven by subjective truth when we run arts organisations, when we create our work, and that subjective truth needs to have a cross-section of narrative from all sorts of cultures, diverse cultures. And I think in order to achieve that, it's really creating the environment or the conditions so that new voices, new ideas, and contexts are born.
Skinder, thank you very much. Maria Oshodi.
Good. Okay. So I've been asked to talk about the another perspective on disability arts and the creative case. And if any of you don't know, I'm blind, as well as the artistic director of Extant. And for those of you who can't see me or can't tell from my surname, I'm also of Nigerian descent with English heritage too. So being a blind, mixed heritage, female, experimental theatre practitioner, it's generally perceived as quite diverse. But funnily enough, it's actually my normality. It's my mainstream, as far as I'm concerned. And it's from this position that I kind of lead to open up another perspective on disability art, one that is possibly more plural than the norm, less confined to single identity boxes, and also where real creative breakthroughs are inclined to happen. So I want to offer some brief examples about this, starting with very recently, last week. Extant was working with Upswing Theatre, Circus Theatre, and Yellow Earth, a South British East Asian theatre company, on a piece of R&D that was supported by Unlimited. And originally, I met the other two directors, Vicky and Kimiko, through the London Hub network, which was part of Sustained Theatre. We gravitated towards working with each other because all three of our companies share a desire to experiment with our practice and discover new artistic territories. And as a result, we're currently collaborating to develop a piece of work called Flight Paths. And this explores circus, music, song, and live description, as well as narrative. And it's inspired by the traditions of Biwa Hoshi players, who were blind, itinerant storytellers and musicians from medieval Japan. And so we're working with a blind Japanese viola player, blind Nigerian soprano, two blind aerialists, and working with them to nurture their personal stories as visually impaired artists in their contemporary migration to the UK. And with them, we are identifying innovative ways of putting access at the heart of live performance to break down the barriers between sighted and visually impaired audiences. And in doing this, we think that the three companies that are working together achieve something that is much bigger than the parts of all of our three companies. As a company, Extant's always taken risks, challenging traditional forms of movement and performance, like clowning, burlesque, physical theatre, with blind and partially sighted performing artists, to subvert, re-enliven, or give new perspectives on these art forms, which leads to things like new interpretations of classics, such as Ionesco's The Chairs, which we toured earlier this year and dealt with themes of ageing and disability. And so as a company, Extant always brings a kind of creative perspective, often from a non-visual starting point, to disrupt received notions that visual impairment and disability is an absolute deprivation, and how instead it can positively shift culturally fixed, cultural sort of norms. For instance, in our Nesta digital art project, Flatland, we're leading research with pioneering robotic engineers, artists and designers to influence how the arts and cultural landscapes can open up their spaces to wider sensory interactions with their audiences than via kind of the usual visual ways of interacting with spaces. And also, it was interesting hearing about some of the audience engagement from the other panelists. And as a company, strategically, we're working on ways to engage with hard-to-reach audiences of visually impaired people, who, unlike sometimes venues kind of want to relate to all disability or sensory impairment in the same way. So there are kind of sometimes more isolation that's experienced by visually impaired audiences as opposed to maybe deaf audiences. And those audiences who we want to reach through our work, we need to, one, create the relationship between the venues that we tour to and those audiences, locate the audiences, as Dawn was talking about, and finding people who can work with those audiences to bring them into the theatres, and then by that, hopefully, kind of create relationships that will make them interested in the work that we are developing and also the rest of the work that the venues are providing. So finally, I just want to say that even though within what would appear a very narrow perspective and experience of making art, the reality of the possibilities are actually very rich, because visual impairment and generally disability are pretty non-discriminatory, affecting all communities, classes and ages, thereby, I think, offering endless combinations of plural reflections on both life and making art. Thanks.
I've got a couple of questions for you, Maria, but actually, because we're slightly overrunning, I'm going to come back to them later when I open up to the audience, and the same with you, Rufus, but perhaps you'd like to set out your stall now.
The question that I was set was, why did I decide to direct Behind the Beautiful Forevers, which we've got running at the National Theatre at the moment? So in a way, it's a much more specific question, but perhaps no less useful from that point of view. For those of you that don't know, Behind the Beautiful Forevers is a book by Catherine Boo, who spent 3.5 years in a slum in Mumbai called Anawadi. And it's not a novel, it's a work of journalism. It was adapted by David Hare, and it's on in the Olivier at the moment. I suppose the principal reason, in fact, the reasons that I do anything fall down to three questions, really. Why do this piece? Why do it in a theatre? And why does this piece want to be done by me? And to answer them in order, it's a fantastic story. It's a great story being told by two great writers. And it's an opportunity to look at what seems to be a very distant community of this distant in terms of the the class of the people, as well as the geographical distance. This community of rubbish collectors and sorters in Anawadi. One of the joys, I think, of theatre, in fact, probably the reason that I believe in theatre, is that it gives an audience an opportunity to stand in other people's shoes. And that's a great challenge, to ask them to stand in the shoes of people who seem to be a long way away. But in fact, with this story, the play is in many ways a play about capitalism, and they are people who, though very distant from us, are very much connected to us in terms of global economics. So in terms of the why do it, there seem to be a lot of very good reasons. Beyond that, of course, there's the diversity question, which is, you know, it's a lovely slice of history to have for the first time an Olivier Theatre that is peopled entirely by British Asians, and obviously, you know, in terms of what everybody's been talking about, audience development and our duty as a national organisation to serve the community that we that for a start, pay for us, but also make up our nation. It's a great opportunity to engage with the British Asian audience, which is, as we know, very, very committed and vital part of our community. So that's another aspect to it. But why theatre was the second question. And that's a really tough one. I always go towards what I'm most scared of, and how you do 56 scenes in a slum and a hospital and a detention centre, and someone sets themselves on fire, and you've really got that challenge of bringing a slum to life on an auditorium which costs God knows how many millions of pounds and has revolves and mechanics that in a way seem completely juxtaposed with the sense of what one's trying to do has been a great mantle to try and pick up. But the most important one is why you. I think there's something that Peter said about, I've got to get this right at the beginning, about reacting to our own history. And certainly with, you know, when you're talking about your visually impaired dad and, you know, everybody around this table, I think that speaks very, very truly to. And for me, that's certainly true as well. Three of the last four pieces I've done at the National Theatre have had 100% diverse casts. And it's no secret that that's a complete reflection of my childhood. The Behind the Beautiful Forevers is really, as I said, a play about...
your childhood, because you were brought up in
overseas.
In Africa and Asia, yeah. I feel very at home. In that room, and also I'm very aware of, on a personal level, of how our arts do not yet fully reflect the community. So it feels a very natural place to be.
I suppose picking up on another point that Peter made in his speech. When do you think a story like this is going to be staged at the National Theatre by someone who isn't white?
Well, the simple answer to that is, of course, there have been. With Ayub Khandin or Kwame or various others, but those are isolated examples, and I think it is a fair question. I think if you look at not just the writers but also the directors, we're not in a state of balance. So, yeah, how does one go about, not in a piece by piece, let's just look at this one and this one, but in culturally, how do we? And kind of in terms of an organisation, how do we take that on? I think it's really about skilling up, actually. There's several ways of going about it, but you've got to look at the long term of how are we going to get... How do we commission writers? And how do we develop directors to take on those big stages? With writers in particular, there's one little initiative that we're doing... that we're starting up. It's quite interesting looking at Behind the Beautiful Forevers and going, well, David Hare... You know, you wouldn't think on the face of it that David Hare is a very obvious candidate for someone to talk about slums in Mumbai, but he is in two crucial other ways. One is he's incredibly skilled, particularly at putting things onto big stages, and the other is he's got a whopping great audience that come to see his work, And, you know, we're doing 82 performances of Behind the Beautiful Forevers and in the Olivier, and that's probably 40 more than we would have done in the Dorfman if David wasn't involved in it. So one has to look at how did David get to that point of craft? And you can look at the plays that he's written and everything else, but you can also look at the adaptations that he's done, that he is continually through his career, like a lot of those very established writers, pitched themselves up against stories that we know to be great. And the way that we treat a lot of diverse writers, I think, is to encourage them to write out of their personal experience, from their personal experience, to ghettoise them in a way and to celebrate that. But actually, Roy Williams is a black writer, or Derby Tucker Green is a black writer, and they're not. They're just writers. So for us as a policy to go, well, if we're going to do this German play in the next couple of years that needs an adaptation, we can employ a certain amount of positive discrimination in going, well, how can we use that as an opportunity to develop a writer who is not normally thought of, but is absolutely as skilled as many of their contemporaries in that way. And I think it's the problem with having, you know, no proportional representation in terms of management and boards is that those decisions are not, it's not deliberate that you go, when it comes to an adaptation of a Chekhov, we're going to think of the usual suspects. It's just habitual, and those habits need to be challenged at every step. I think one of the problems that we've got in this country, it's a problem and a good thing, is that there aren't these imposed quotas that rebalance the casting in American television, for example. But because they're not imposed, quite often they're not adhered to. And I think, in as pragmatic a way, we as an organisation have to keep a keen eye on that. I could talk about that forever.
So just push beyond your comfort zone.